Hello, this is Professor Kitch. Welcome to this webcast in my Introduction to Geotechnical Engineering series. This webcast is the second of two webcasts on earthwork in the field. This webcast will discuss compaction equipment and the variables which control the compaction process. After viewing this webcast, you should be able to describe the different types of compaction equipment and their pros and cons, select an appropriate piece of equipment for a given soil, and describe how the key variables of weight, number of passes, and lift thickness affect compaction. We must start this webcast with a short description of the processes active in compaction. The compactability of soils is highly dependent on the soil type. The processes which are effective in compacting clay soils are not the same as those that are effective in compacting gravel soils. Broadly speaking, there are four different processes active in the soil compaction process. The first is pressure. The weight of the compaction equipment divided by its contact area with the soil generates high pressures, which will compress the soil. The second process is impact. Some compaction techniques, like the one we will use to compact soils in the lab, impart a series of blows to the soil, which compact the soil. Vibration is another process which aids in compaction of soil. Vibration can help to rearrange the soil particles into a denser configuration. And finally, manipulation, which consists of shearing and kneading the soil, is beneficial in the compaction of cohesive soils. For effective and efficient compaction, these processes must be matched to the specific characteristics of the soil being compacted. There are many different types of compaction equipment, too many to really be counted. However, they can all be described by certain characteristics. The first is how the compactor is moved. Some are towed behind separate tractors, and some are self-propelled. The weight is clearly an important characteristic of soil compactors. Whether the equipment uses a static load or includes vibrating or impacting load is also an important characteristic. And finally, the shape of the compacting surface is important. This surface can either be smoothed or footed. The best way to describe compaction equipment is with pictures, so that's what we'll do. This photo shows a self-propelled footed vibratory compactor. You can see the feet sticking out of the rollers of the compactor. When this compactor is driven over a loose lift of fill, the high pressures on the rollers push the feet into the fill material. This uses both pressure and manipulation to compact the soils. When the soil is loose, the feet penetrate fully into the fill. As the compacted fill gets stronger, the feet will ride out of the top of the compacted fill. This is called walking out. The rollers are equipped with large vibrators, which can be turned on or off to aid in the compacting process. Footed rollers such as these are especially good with cohesive fills, since manipulation is an effective process in compacting clay soils. This is a photo of a self-propelled pneumatic tired roller. You can see a row of five smooth tires on the front of the machine. There are four similar tires on the back of the machine, place in the spaces between the front tires. This compactor uses primarily pressure to compact the soil. The offset tires provide some manipulation, though much less than that produced by a footed roller. This type of compactor can be used for both cohesive soils and granular soils, though it's not very effective for highly plastic clay soils. This is also a type of compactor used for compacting hot mix asphalt. This is an example of a self-propelled vibratory smooth drum roller. It's very good in compacting granular soils, sands, and gravels. Vibration is very effective in compacting these types of soils. This type of equipment is often used for the finishing passes on fill because it leaves a smooth surface. This is our first example of a towed compactor. The yellow piece of equipment is the actual compactor, and it's being towed by a rubber-belted tractor. This is called a high energy impact roller. Because the rollers are not round, they rise and fall on the fill material. In this way, they use pressure, vibration, and impact to compact the soil. This equipment is very good at compacting coarse gravel materials. Because of its high energy levels, it can compact thicker lift layers than other equipment. The high energy impact roller is not used much in North America, though it is common in both Europe and Asia. Compactors come in different sizes for different purposes. This is a small version of the footed roller we saw earlier. This one is remotely controlled by the operator and can access small areas. Like its larger cousin, it's good for compacting cohesive soils. When compacting sand in small and tight quarters, a hand-controlled vibratory pan compactor, such as the one shown here, can be very effective. Again, vibration is good for compacting cohesionless soils. I'd like to close this webcast by overviewing the field variables that affect the compaction process. Before I start discussing the variables, let's review the process of placing and compacting fill. First, we dump our fill material on the desired location. Next, we smooth the material out with a dozer to a uniform lift thickness. If needed, we then moisture condition the soil. Finally, we use a piece of compaction equipment to compress and compact the soil. There are a number of variables in this process. Let's discuss them. The moisture content is critically important in the compaction of clay and silty soils. It's less critical in compacting clean sands and gravels. It's so important to the process that we will have an entire lab class devoted to measuring the effects of moisture on compaction. As we just got through discussing, the type of equipment is important in soil compaction, and the equipment must be properly matched to the type of soil. Finally, I want to discuss the concept of compaction energy per unit volume. This will help explain some of the key variables that affect compaction in the field. The first of these variables is weight. I could choose a small compactor for my earthwork project or a larger, heavier compactor. It should be obvious that increasing the weight of the compactor will increase the compaction energy imparted to the soil and will increase compaction. A second variable is the number of passes we use when compacting a lift. I don't have to drive the compactor over the lift just once. I can drive it over the soil many times. For a given piece of equipment, if I increase the number of passes, I will increase the compaction energy imparted to the soil. The final field variable I can control is the lift thickness, or the thickness of the soil layer I'm compacting. I can place the soil in a relatively thin lift before compacting, or I can place the soil in a much thicker lift. If I keep the compaction equipment and number of passes the same, increasing the lift thickness will decrease the compaction energy per unit volume because I'm putting the same amount of energy in a larger volume of soil. So the key variables we have in the field control of the compaction process are compaction moisture content, type of equipment, weight of equipment, number of passes of the equipment, and the lift thickness. I hope you've enjoyed this webcast on compaction equipment and field variables. I'll leave you now with a time-lapse video of the earthwork done to prepare the site for the construction of the Hunter Strain Engineering Lab at Angelo State University. Have a great day.